A couple of years ago, I recorded a video at the Canal and River Trust's workshop in Birmingham, where they make brand new lock gates out of huge tree trunks of wood. And at the time, a few people said to me, that's all very lovely seeing how they're made, but how do they actually install them? So I've come along today to Thorn near Doncaster to see an old lock gate being taken out, and then in a week, couple of weeks' time, I'll be back to see them put the new one in.
This is the Stainforth and Keadby Canal. 15 miles long, it joins the Sheffield and South Yorkshire navigation to the River Trent, running mostly through quiet countryside. It's only got three locks along its length, and this one at Thorn is the middle one. As you can see, taking off both sets of gates, top and bottom, is a rather massive undertaking, involving, for the bottom gates, a floating crane mounted on a special boat. And there's a lot of water pumping going on as well, but we'll come back to that shortly.
This is a first for this crane boat, Pride of Collingham. Because at length, 110 foot I believe she is, we've had to fetch her in off at Trent, at Keadby, on level tide, and then two tugs has assisted her, one at arse end, one at head, shove her up, and obviously reverse rolls to get her back down. So she's going to be lifting bottom gates, which weigh about just short of 4 tonne, onto our works hoppers, and then we'll sail away.
These are brand new lock gates waiting to be installed. They're sitting on the barge which brought them here, moored just above the lock.
Everything's planned and calculated, so we what we call have lift plans. So we know how much the gates weigh. The old gates, when we take out, we always had 25% for water content. So we're in that range. We're safely in that range of lifting. The crane boat, you'll probably see later on, she's got tanks, what we call lifting tanks that bolt at side. And I think she's quite capable of something like, again, about 12 tonne, I believe. She'll lift about 12 tonne with tanks on. So she's well in the limits, you know.
12 wooden planks are used to hold back the canal water while the work is underway in the lock. Inevitably, some water does still leak through. This is pumped away from the working area into the bottom of the lock, from where it and any other water rising up through the ground can be pumped up and out into the lower level of the canal, below the bottom gates. But there's an even bigger pumping issue.
You've got 14 miles of canal from here down to Keadby. You're 5 miles top. Because there's no byway, we've got to manually overpump with pumps. And logistics of getting that right at mini has been a bit of an headache.
These are the pumps that are shifting all that water. It goes up this pipe from the canal, over the road, and down alongside the lock until it can be released into the lower pound. The pumping's not just to keep the higher pound from overflowing, but also to keep supplies going to a power station further down. It's a task not helped by some pump failures they had, and some low-life scrote nicking the thick copper power cable to the pumps. It was time to start removing the lower gates, and the first task was taking off the old metal handrails. For that purpose, a grinding tool was employed, the man wielding it held from falling by a rope tied to a harness. The crane held the railings taut, and when the final bit was sheared, they were lifted clear. Now to attach the straps from the crane onto the gate itself. But where? The gate has no holes to run them through, else of course it would leak in normal use. No problem, the team had a solution. Yes, you chainsaw out chunks of the woodwork. Cuts made, a sledgehammer was lowered from above, and the wood hammered free. Now the crane swung around, and very hefty straps were attached. Thank you. These were then raised into place above the gate and lowered down. A rope was also lowered down from the lock side and attached to the straps through the newly created hole in the gate. Thus, the straps could be pulled through the gate and up to the crane. With one strap tight, a second was attached the same way. The only thing holding the gate from toppling was the steel collar at the top. This too was ground off and made to come free with a Thumpomatic 3000, otherwise known as a lump hammer. That's it. The gate dangles, held by the crane, and up it goes. The immediate plan was simply to move it out of the way, putting it below the lock. Steadied with guy lines, the gate was rotated out of the chamber. After I'd gone, the old gate would be loaded onto a barge and taken away, in part for recycling or other disposal. And exactly the same process took care of the second lower gate. A good job done without a hitch.
It's now 3 weeks since the old lock gates were taken off, and in that time the lock has been fettled, ready for new ones, and indeed new gates have been hung at the top. Now they'll hang the new pair at the bottom of the lock.
These are the new gates at the top. You can see how they fit against the concrete sill at the base, so as to form a watertight seal when closed. At the bottom, preparations were underway for a crane to hang the new gates there, a process that, once again, has been carefully planned.
Lock gates obviously laid in bottom of the boat. We put wires in, lifting wires, and tighten them up, one side separate to the other one. So obviously we have to have it hung straight. If it don't hang straight, we can't get it unpinned in bottom. So obviously it has to be bang on plumb.
I'd arrived just in time, as the gate was immediately hoisted into the air from the boat where it had been lying. And it was swung around over the lock and lowered into position. The corner was slotted into its run. And the idea was to drop it onto that pin on which the gate can pivot. And this design has changed.
We call them pins, but these pots weigh about 100 kg a piece. These pots, we're called pots and pins. On this, they're a plate that's bolted to the floor. The existing ones was a pin. So it's just the way how they've redesigned for strength, just a new way of working, basically.
Because at bottom at locking old ones, there were round pots and pin one in gate. Now they've completely reversed that. Now we've got a pinning bottom at lock and porting bottom at gate. The standardising them all through country.
A relief then to see the gate drop straight into place. Until the weight of the gate could be held by a new collar at the top, wooden chocks were forced under the end to hold it up. At this point, a teensy problem emerged. The collar wouldn't fit around the metal rubbing band at the top of the brand new gate. Quite simply, the band had been made too thick, and it has to be there, else the wood would wear away every time the gate swings open. A lot of staring and pointing and head scratching took place. The crane lifted the gate while much pondering was undertaken. Ultimately, the only, albeit temporary, solution was to grind the new steel band off the new gate and immediately order another better fitting one to be made, which could hopefully be put in place before the end of the works. This was simply a human error of mismeasurement at some point.
It didn't fit. Gate were half inch wider than old ones, so we've had to cut the steel band off, and then we'll replace that later on.
While that took place, I had a look at the other work going on, which included plenty of repairs to the blockwork. This is repointing on a grand scale, with a lime mortar in the tradition of which the lock was originally constructed. New, longer ladders were also being hung on the lock walls. And in the middle of it all, a water vole was spotted scurrying around the bottom of the lock. Water voles are protected in law, so this meant it had to be caught, carefully, and released further up the canal, which I'm pleased to say it was later that day. It did seem largely unbothered by everything going on around it. Meanwhile, back at the top of the gate, the steel band had been removed and the collar could now be pushed into place, with the usual help from the thumpomatic. Strips of metal run through holes in the collar mean it'll hold against the weight of the gate trying to fall forwards. Here's a better view of the finished work. Down below, the chocks were removed and the gate swung freely on its new pot and pin. This is the result of all that effort. The lock open for boats again, the new gate looking shiny. Yes, they do leak, but it takes a while for the wood to absorb a bit of water, swell up and form a proper seal. The handrails are back on, along with hydraulics for the sluices and the gates themselves, for these are powered locks, unusual for most of the canal network, which you generally have to push open. Here, you just push a button. Look, it's magic. And that's it. The new gate should last another 25 to 30 years. Thanks for watching. Cheerio.